Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 24 of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast. So as this podcast is airing, it is literally a couple of days before Social Media Marketing World 2017 in San Diego. And to celebrate, we've been spotlighting guests who are speaking at Social Media Marketing World 2017, including Brian Fanzo, Park Howe, and today's guest, Jay Acunzo. Now, Social Media Marketing World is the premier social media marketing event of the year. It is not inexpensive. It is an investment. However, if you're listening to this the day it comes out, you can still get tickets by going to bit.ly/MD_SMMW17. If you go get your tickets through that link, it would help out the show tremendously. Unfortunately, with it being just a couple days before the actual event, all the specials are over. No more early bird discounting, but you can still get those live in-person tickets. Or if, like myself, the travel plus the ticket is just entirely too much, you can get virtual tickets as well by going to bit.ly/MD_SMMW17. And so, keeping the social media marketing world train rolling, today's guest is Mr. Jay Acunzo. Jay is an award-winning podcaster and dynamic keynote speaker. Before creating Unthinkable, Jay was a digital media strategist at Google and head of content at HubSpot. He's built content marketing strategies from scratch for startups and produce attention-grabbing documentaries for brands. His work has been cited in places ranging from Harvard Business School to the Washington Post. Today, Jay hosts shows and works with teams who aspire to be the exceptions to all the noise in their niche. And without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Social Media Marketing World speaker, Jay Acunzo. Jay, thanks so much for joining me.
My pleasure, man. I'm excited to be here.
So you are the prototype for success, at least for myself. You are the host of an award-winning podcast. You speak, you help businesses, but it wasn't always like that. Nobody starts at the top. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
Yeah, you know what? I actually tripped into it, if I'm being completely honest. I actually wanted to be a sports journalist. And in school, so I went to Trinity College, a really small liberal arts school in Hartford, Connecticut. I got a scholarship for sports writing. I wrote for the paper. I had a brief internship with the Hartford Current, which is like Connecticut's oldest sports paper or paper in general. So I wrote for a print publication, if you could believe it, multiple, actually. And I graduated in 08, right around the same time that the economy had tanked. And so I was kind of scrambling. You know, print was going south pretty quickly, and I didn't want to move to any city that I didn't want to move to. And that's really what you have to do to break into sports. So honestly, on a whim, I just started applying to tech companies I thought were interesting in Boston and New York. And I don't know how to explain it, but I got a role at Google as my first job out of school, and had just sent my online resume like through a form that they had on their website, and it was like right place, right time, I guess. I don't really know how to explain it, but the only way I can explain it is fate, because I actually met my wife there at that job. So I got into digital marketing. I got to see Google, which was great, and then I got to meet my wife. So I'm very, very blessed, very lucky about that experience. But it completely was not something of my doing. It was just like the fate deciding for me where I was going to go next, I guess.
Amazing. I can definitely see that playing out as a made-for-TV movie. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? And it's like, okay, it's time to get down to brass tacks. Kind of like marriage, right? When you first meet this new person, she can do no wrong. And then you get married and you figure out she snores like a dying moose and has all of these other quirks. So when did the sort of, you know, that glow come off and it's like, all right, things just got real?
Yeah, time to move on from Google, right? So you know what? It's funny. The show I host weekly now, Unthinkable, it really has, we don't overtly state this because it's not the big idea that we're hammering home, but it's the belief that I have that underpins it, which is I just believe that there's something more to this work that we do, whatever we're doing. You could be an accountant and you could tell me how much you love being in a spreadsheet all day. I won't get that. But if you're lighting up, I'd listen to you talk for hours about it. Or, you know, on the other end, if it's like for me as a creator, as a writer, those moments where you just geek out over a joke that you think will land as you write it, you're home alone, head down, doing your work, and you just can't get enough of it. And I didn't have that feeling at Google. Like everything around the job was great, the perks, the brand, the people. But the job itself, when I had to go back to my desk, I actually really dreaded. And so, you know, one of the things that happened to me that really slapped me over the face with that realization was, something wasn't sitting right for like a couple of years. I remember one friend of mine sent me a YouTube video that I watched like 5 or 6 times in a row. It was like one of those videos that, you know, you can't get enough of. Mm-hmm. And I went home and I was going to show it to my friends, my roommates at the time. And I hit play as I was like overselling them, overhyping this video, and a pre-roll ad started. So not the video that we'd asked for, but a frustrating experience without the skip button. And my first thought in my head was a little weird, but the ad started to play and I thought, damn it, Eric, because Eric was my colleague at Google whose client was this advertiser, and he'd sold the idea to the advertiser to run YouTube ads. And now I was experiencing what was really frustrating. And then I had this really terrible realization, which was, well, wait a sec. I have the same job at Google that Eric has, which means that somebody somewhere was cursing the name of the person responsible for this frustrating experience in their day, and they didn't know it, but that person responsible was me.
Right.
And with YouTube scale, that was thousands, if not millions of people. So that was one crystallizing moment, but I'll be honest with you, like the whole time I was there, I was like so grateful to be there and so excited about the potential of it. But when it was time to put my head down and do my work, I was miserable. And so since leaving, I got into content marketing and then worked for a couple startups, both big and small, and a VC firm as well. But I haven't looked back. I'm like pursuing that moment at every turn where nobody is working with you. You're alone. You have to do your work and you're lighting up. Like all I want to do is find those moments. But I also want to tell the stories on my show of people who find those moments too.
Thank you so much for sharing that. Yeah, I was listening to a couple episodes before we got on here. And the messiness of creating, I forget the lady's name. I think her name was Angela. And she was sharing about how she was struggling picking back up her camera, and that just resonated with me completely, because I've never gotten into photography, mm-hmm. but just the process of, okay, you do this thing, it's for you, but then when you put it out, it's no longer for you,
right.
And that agony of it. So I dig it. So if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms of space time continuum,
I love that caveat.
Yeah, we watch Doctor Who over here. What are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Spend more time reflecting about who you are and really try to figure that out first. I think whether that's self-awareness or just internal peace or whatever you want to phrase that as, like, don't try to figure out what others are doing and follow them. You know, stand on the shoulders of giants. Don't lean on them for a crutch. And so I think, you know, with the Google example, the first thought in my head when I was thinking of leaving was, well, who am I to leave a company like this? Like, isn't that selfish of me? And, you know, maybe you can construe it that way. But I think in reality, it's like, well, if I'm not happy doing that and I only get to live on this earth once, then I should leave. You know, I shouldn't be a jerk about it. I shouldn't like beat my chest about how much I dislike a company or how much like, you know, people at Google or X or RY, because I don't feel that way. Or I shouldn't coach you. Hey, don't work for a big company because big companies X, Y, and Z. Like, no, this is all personal. This is all contextual to me. So that's the very first thing I would say, is like really just execute against what is truly you and authentically you, and use what everyone else is telling you to do as just data points that you can synthesize together. I think we live in this era where there's so much advice, and you're getting some now from me. It's just a data point, right? Like put it in your brain along with everything that makes you you, and then kind of decide for yourself what you want to do next.
Gotcha. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because I follow mobile really heavily, and they talk about the Internet of Things and connected devices. And sort of the default example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered to you via Amazon drone. And there has been discussion in the marketing community, like, okay, are marketers going to have a job in that scenario? And they call it a closed loop system, because you don't actually have to leave the house. Everything is automated like the Jetsons. So where do you see the future of marketing being when we actually get to that Jetsons future, and everything, you know, sort of takes care of itself from an automation standpoint?
These are fun questions because who the hell really knows, right? Like if you were to say today that this is the reality of the tech world and the way we communicate and buy, and then go back in time 8 years, nobody would predict it to be the way it is today. So I love these questions, but my real answer is who the heck knows. But if I had to extrapolate out, anything that could be templatized and repeated rather easily through that template is very quickly going to be automated. And so there's centuries of precedent for this, whether it's the advent of the printing press or the Industrial Revolution or the internet age, like everything that you can do on repeat without having critical thought or artistic thought behind it, that's where the realm of humans stops being as powerful as it can be and the realm of machines is much better. So in the future, you know, you're going to have those liberal arts students, you're going to have those people who can question the convention, who can test their way forward instead of just stick to a list of best practices. Like, I think the future is a lot of very interesting experiments and creativity because it's going to be about maximizing what humans are best at. Humans are not best at repeatable actions where there is a right answer, where there's a binary system. That's for machines. So the closer you get to something called automation, the closer you are to being obsolete. And in marketing, there's a whole field called marketing automation. So now it's how you use the tool, right? Like it's not just the input-output system. It's getting creative and being atypical with the use of automation, or it's not using that at all and actually thinking more about the story of your brand or what have you. But long and short of it is, if you're a critical thinker, if you're willing to break from convention and question what is now repeatable, like that is going to be the role of people in the future.
Ditto that. I am one of those cord-cutting millennials. I don't have cable. I have a Roku box. And one of the channels I watch is Curiosity Stream. And there's this scientist, Michio Kaku, who's a futurist. And he says very much the same thing. He says, if it's repeatable, if it's templatable, that's all gone. But machines kind of suck at the creative side and things that can't be templated. So yeah. He says very much the same thing.
I have a very like powerful moment in my career where I realized that. I was head of content for HubSpot, and we were writing a lot of articles or trying to push, you know, some opinion pieces out into the world for some thought leadership. And what I realized is like those pieces generated a lot of traffic and maybe some leads, but they weren't getting a lot of buyers. And so what we started to do was give away basically pieces of the product, like templates for things, like in spreadsheet form that you could download and use. And then what I realized is like, okay, so a template like that is very close to technology. It's basically like one step removed. Like you could almost be an entrepreneur, come up with like a template in a spreadsheet, and I've actually seen some people do this, that mimics a product, test the market, and then build software based on what you learn. And so like what I realized was, wow, like as soon as you get to the template level, you're one really small step away from automation and technology. And so if your job just requires you to download that template and follow it, you're adding no critical thinking, and the person that you are is thrown to the wind. Like, I think that's the beauty of this future I'm painting, is the individual and what makes the individual unique really does matter in that future. It's not just any marketer who can follow an instruction. It's you, the individual, applying who you are to your work.
Deep waters, my friend, deep waters. So you, Brian Solis, and Andrew Davis, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, Jay Bear, whoever, you're all chilling at the bar after the conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
I think one of the things I've been railing against lately is why everybody views creativity as something that has to be necessarily big. And I think what happens, I call this the green smoothie problem. So someone hands you a green smoothie and you have no idea what's in it. It's just in a glass and you've never had one before. Like your first instinct is going to be like, ew, gross. What the heck is in this? And now like you're at a disadvantage from me. I've given you the smoothie. I know what's in it. You don't. And you're going to do one of two things. You're going to anchor to stuff you already know. Oh, it looks like broccoli. It's gross. Or you're going to ask for some proof from other people. Do others drink this? Can you tell me someone I know that drinks this? Is there a case study that I should drink this? Like, that's a terrible way to get a new idea to be accepted by other people. That's what we do in marketing. Here's the new idea. Here's the new tactic. The person receiving it's at a disadvantage. I think far better and far more needed in marketing is explain how you got there. Explain the ingredients in that smoothie. So, oh, hey, it's banana and kiwi and it's got some spinach and it's got some apple. oh, great, that sounds good. I now understand where you're coming from. I will accept this. I will drink this. Or, you know what? I don't really like spinach, but let's have a productive conversation about the ingredients and the path you got to the smoothie with, and maybe go to a V2 and you'll push through this idea to that executive or pitching. But long story short, I just think we think of creativity wrong. It's not, here's this brilliant idea and it's fully baked and I'm giving it to you. It's, here is my thought process. Here is my work ethic. Here's what I'm informed by with the customer and with you, the executive, or my client. Let me lay it all out on the table for you, and let's have a really productive conversation. But what we anchor to is Red Bull launching people from space, or American Express throwing tons of money at their editorial, or GE with their podcasts, or Marriott with their videos, and it's all amazing stuff. But we get the final like green smoothie, and we're like, well, I'm not them, so I'm just going to write terrible kind of short-sighted blog post to rank on search. So for me, I want to, you know, I've talked to those individuals about like, how do you guys coach other people to think of creativity like a process, like a work ethic, instead of like this muse striking you or this like beautifully finished product? Because I actually think that's a worse way to pitch ideas anyway.
I like that analogy a lot. We've never met in person, but I'm fat and I'm trying to get less fat. And so that green smoothie just resonated with me like you don't know how, because, you know, when you're trying to change your eating habits and diets and whatnot, people put all this kale and all of these other things in front of you. Like, what the heck is this? And like you said, you're at a disadvantage and you don't want to come off as ignorant. So it's like, oh, I like this. I don't. Yep. So anyway.
No, I feel you, man. I'm Italian. So if I came home and I live in Cambridge, Massachusetts now. So like it's a city with lots of hipsters and I'm kind of like blending in with that group now. And it's like, if I came home and said, oh, I'm vegan now, my grandma would be like, what kind of beef is that? You know, like what kind of pasta is that? It's just not the world I'm
from. Is that veal? Like what is that? Cool, cool. So I dig it. So we're going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to continue with Mr. Jay Acunzo. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Jay, without getting political, what's your take on the whole fake news fallout after the 2016 election? And just to back up for those who don't know, because everybody's, because every podcast is somebody's first podcast, in the last 3 months leading up to the election, fake news started to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, we mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. It wasn't a simple matter of spinning the stories one direction or another. There were no underlying facts to spin. And this has sparked a really interesting debate in the social media and digital marketing communities, because at first, Mark Zuckerberg sort of scoffed at the accusations. Oh, it's highly unlikely Facebook had anything to do with it. But then in an open letter in February, he admitted that fake news has outstripped Facebook's ability to govern it or police it. And so now they're in the process of coming up with artificial intelligence and other third-party verifications to sort of curb that. And you have people on different sides of the fence. You have some people who are straight First Amendment. They're like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have other people who are like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say you're away on business and some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool and one of them drowns or hurt themselves. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. Doesn't matter. It happened on your property. You are responsible. So where do you stand? You know, again, from the marketing perspective, where do you stand on this whole discussion around fake news and alternative facts?
I'm fascinated by where it came from and how people are surprised by it. So, for example, when you have an original story and it's a factual story, whether it's news or, you know, you're trying to give an opinion about something as a marketer or teach somebody something as a marketer, if you start with just presenting it in plain light, you know, it's like it's not a sensationalized headline, but it's very valuable stuff. You're going to get beat on all the clicks and impressions and things that marketers look at, for better or worse, by the people that do use clickbait headlines, right? So now what happens is people start to take something real, a news story, for example, and sensationalize like the wrapper around it, right? So they have a sensationalized headline to get you to click, and then they make money as a news organization on media sales. Or they get a lot of views and clicks and downloads of their ebook as a marketer, and they can show their boss and get promoted. It's always back to incentives and business models here. But it started with real things being sensationalized. Then it moved to hunting for the sensational in a real thing. And then whoever's creating all this fake news, whether they started with this logic or not, can look at all that and be like, why don't we just stop anchoring to stuff that holds back the sensationalism and just create the most sensationalist thing possible? And because that's what's working, right? So they did. And so it's like there's a logical series of steps that actually comes from genuine news outlets or blogs, whether it's from a brand or media company, historically. And so, I mean, that's a shame, but it's also fixable. It's fixable if you stop clinging to convention as a media outlet. Like, you can make money on paid subscription, on selling services, on selling products. Like, you don't have to sell the audience. You can sell to the audience. There's all sorts of ways that media can dig itself out of this hole, but they're on this like crack for them, which is ad sales. And ad sales is about big top line numbers. And when you have all these platforms where people are reacting because they're people to sensationalism, the winner is the one that is pure, unfiltered sensationalism. It's like saying we have a candy bar, but we have a few healthy ingredients in it. Like it's a granola bar with laced with chocolate, or we have the most delicious chocolate bar out there. People are going to run to the latter because that's what they want. And media is struggling because they're trying to monetize the same way as the fake news organizations are. They got all these clicks and impressions they need to get to their ad sales teams to flip to advertisers, right? But they can't play the same game because they want to put some granola in that candy bar because they're actual news. So it's not going to be like an even playing field if you play that game. The real media has to play an entirely different game. And I think they have to look very hard at their business model to start changing the game.
Your analogies are amazing. I don't know if anyone's ever told you that, but just the way you put things, and like I said, maybe it's because I'm a big boy and I like food analogies, but the way you put it just makes sense. It makes a lot of sense.
Hey, I got to be completely honest. I have gotten that a lot and I take pride in it, but it's also, I'm an English lit major and I'm pretty sure the way those degrees work is you only get a return on that investment if you speak in analogy like 60% of the time. time. So I'm just getting the return on my investment here.
Love it. I love it. So, you know, large corporations are just now really starting to get serious about digital marketing. For a very long time, they were sort of treating it like a fad, waiting for it to blow over, especially in regards to social media. But now they're starting to put corporate dollars into digital ad spend. And those corporate dollars are disproportionately going to Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. Just those two alone, they're gobbling up most of the corporate dollars. And as money starts to flow into limited ad inventory, the laws of supply and demand say, you know, those prices for the clicks are going to start to rise, which we've already seen. And some have posited that we may enter a future here soon when you have the haves and the have nots in terms of digital marketing, because the, you know, the corporations are throwing around those elephant dollars and the smaller players get pushed out. So do you think that, you know, that's a plausible future outcome, or do you think that, you know, disruptive forces that they are, the internet will stay open and free?
I think it's not ever, I don't think it's ever been the case that small organizations competed on a paid media basis with big organizations one-to-one. There was always a disadvantage, whether it was TV or print. And I think all organizations are better served if they do this, but I think small organizations by definition have to, which is look for the arbitrage opportunities. So right now, Facebook is a semi-arbitrage opportunity. I can get a lot more attention from people and a lot more targeting than elsewhere, and then the prices really dictate. At one point, Google AdWords was that way, where you could pay very little for 1 to 2 word keywords and rank pretty highly on the paid side. But now, as more giant brands start throwing more money, it starts to get more competitive, and whether they're large brands or just more, you start to get squeezed out and the return isn't there. So, you know, yeah, now it's Facebook, or, you know, I think right on the cusp of Facebook getting too expensive, Instagram will follow, and then there's Snapchat. Like, there's always going to be people moving where they spend their time and attention. And there's different ways you can get into those people's worlds. And it doesn't have to be pay to play. And it doesn't have to be pay to play in the same places as all those big brands. So what I like about the small business and where their advantage really lies is they're incredibly nimble. Like, they can move really quickly. I've come from the startup world and I've seen Google at scale. I saw HubSpot at scale. I saw a couple organizations that were small. And then at a VC firm, worked with 60 plus startups that were really small. They can change on a dime. So if all of a sudden they're like, wait, our audience is actually flowing over to this new channel, they don't have to have 17 meetings and talk to 12 agencies to do it. They just do it the next day. Like, that is the weapon. That is the power that small businesses have. It's never going to be the budget. It's going to be the brains.
Absolutely. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time, but I am going to take just a few moments to set it up because I really want you to understand why I'm asking it the way I'm asking it and where I'm driving. And it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. But in my personal and professional opinion, there's a severe gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. It's more like a gaping hole. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a corporation or at an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs. So The way to professionalize yourself is you sort of start off meandering the wilds of Google. And while there is some very good information out there, contrary to popular belief, rooting it out does take a little bit of skill. I mean, you might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up doing Amway. Or you could do what I did, which is go back and get a degree in internet marketing. But the cons to that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000. And it's time consuming. Even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. But by far, the most prevalent way of professionalizing oneself and disseminating best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less expensive than going back to college, you have to have that money up front and it's out of pocket. So take some of your better conferences like a South by Southwest or MozCon or Social Media Marketing World. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. And that doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, food for however many days. Nope, that's just to have your face in that place. And once you add all those other things back in, you're looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a conference. And again, while that investment is a lot cheaper than, you know, going to Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac to go to college, because of the out-of-pocket nature of it, it's still beyond a lot of people's, you know, ability to afford. Like, they get priced out of it. So I'm trying to sort of crowdsource a way of professionalizing oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or, you know, having to come out of pocket $5,000, which you may be in a life situation where you're just not able to swing. So now that I'm finished rambling for however many minutes, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Jay. You have somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Yeah, I love this, because let's make it really practical and how we would do it. So with the education context that you gave me, so the goal here is learning and making real connections to then sort of level up as you go. I would probably jump on Twitter and I would start to, you know, search for the things I personally care about. So I would look for, you know, on a general level, content marketing. I would look for creativity in marketing. I look for podcasting, things like that. I would just basically start to lurk, and I would spend a lot of my time reading and actually engaging. And then what I would do is look to add value back. I think this is what people don't do, is they reach out, hey, I admire X, I admire Y about you. Can we get together and have some coffee? And I think the me of 3 years ago, before I knew I was going to be a full-time entrepreneur, I would have been like, hell yeah. Oh my God, I'm so flattered. Now I'm like still incredibly flattered, but I'm like, oh my God, my schedule is screaming no, not because I'm at all any better than anyone. It's just because, like, oh my gosh, I can't, right? So I just literally can't shake free. So I wouldn't want to ask to meet people to make those connections. I would read, consume, understand context. That's step one, context. Number two is I would find ways to add value to them. And it could be as simple as, I'm going to write a response piece to what I heard them say, or saw them write, or heard them say on a podcast or whatever. And I'm going to start to create basically an owned channel. So that's step two, is I'm going to string up a blog or something I know I'm uniquely good at, a video channel on YouTube, or, you know, preferably hosted on my own site. And then I'm going to start to engage these people, not directly, not one-to-one, but one-to-many. And I can start to follow up with what they said and say, you know what, I really liked your take on X that you wrote about. I have my own take here. Here is a tease of it. So you don't have to read or watch the whole thing. What do you think? And if I like that tease, it's like the kind of appetizer to the meal. Yeah, I'll have the whole meal if I'm that person you're trying to reach. You know, I would just start to give. And it's so easy from a content standpoint to give. I'd start to hit up all the people that I wanted to reach. I would start to use what I'm best at, which is storytelling, which is distillation of complex ideas into simple things like analogies, like you pointed out, and just start to do tons of work until they reacted positively. And honestly, if I'm being completely honest here, this is what I did. Like, I was doing it on my own blog. I was doing it from a corporation, but I was like reading the people I wanted to meet as speakers to become a speaker. And I would just write stuff in response to what they were writing and send it to them. And I had the chops to impress them, or to at least have a joke or two land they liked. And now it's like a warm introduction when I say, can I meet you at this conference, or can I meet you offline for coffee, instead of just a cold rip the band-aid moment that they're likely to say no to. So to sum all that up, number one is get real deep in the context of who you want to meet and what they say, understand them as people. Number two is add value to them, whether you start to produce stuff for free for their cause, or, you know, just respond to them through what you're creating. And then number three, I would actually then reach out to them with the value you've created, not with an overture to meet. And what'll happen is good stuff will come your way. Like, blessings come back your way when you start to grow your body of work like that.
And there you have it, folks. I hope you guys were taking as many notes as I have, because this has blessed me just in my personal. So Jay, please take a moment. Tell us about your podcast. Tell us about your any upcoming events you got going on, social media handles. Where can we get some more you?
The URL is unthinkable.fm. And let me be honest, I'm going to speak directly to your listeners here. You don't need another marketing podcast. You don't need another tips and tricks approach to interviewing someone, but you might need some stories that make you think and feel really deeply about what you do for work. That's what Unthinkable really is. It's like a travel show. We go visit a location, but it's a mental one, and we go really deep and find all the hidden nuance and complexity and emotion, and tell a lot of really deep stories with music. So I believe it's unlike anything that people are producing on the podcast side right now. I'd let you decide that, but all I want you to know is it's not like a marketing show that you've heard. All we're trying to do is create something not better, but different. And if that sounds exciting to you, I hope you go and check that out. So the name of the show is just Unthinkable.
And there you have it, Jay. Thanks so much. I greatly appreciate it.
Thank you, brother. This is lots of fun.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.